Alaska Live TV. Music and conversation from the KUAC FM studio is made possible by a grant from Design Alaska. Architecture and engineering for the new frontier.
Thanks for joining me for Alaska Live. I'm your host, Lori Neufeld. Here in the studio with me, Francisco Gonzalez, Mexican harpist, and Michael Ronstadt. Thanks, guys, for joining me.
Thank you, Lori.
Thank you.
You came all the way up here from
Tucson, Arizona.
Tucson, Arizona. That was a long flight, so thanks for making it up in time to do the show.
My arms are really tired from flapping.
What's the plan? We have a beautiful Mexican harp that Francisco Gonzalez brought here, and Michael Ronstadt, you brought your guitar. So tell me what you're going to play first off.
I'm going to do a solo of a song that was written over 100 years ago. And it's a song that was like the theme song of the people who during the Mexican Revolution decided to come to the United States because they were there. The land was in so much conflict. My family, my father's family, was in Aguascalientes, which is the exact geographical center of Mexico. And the people from the north would come down and go through the city and ravage it. And then the people from the south would come up to fight and they'd ravage it. Finally, my grandfather, who had been in the United States earlier, had come to work here in the railroad in the 1890s, I believe, said, that's it, we have to get out of here. And my father came, he was 4 years old, and they lived in a boxcar in Kansas City.
In Kansas City?
Yeah, for the first couple of years of his life. So this song is called Cuatro Milpas, which means the four cornfields, small cornfields, plots. And in the song, I'm going to do it instrumentally, but the song talks about that's the only thing left of what was my house, my ranch. That left us four little plots. And it was, like I say, the theme song of those who came here. And it evokes a very great sadness. But it also became, nowadays, like symbolized that, you know, many of us have grown beyond the limitations that we had when we were in Mexico. And, you know, all my brothers and sisters were born here and stuff. And my father was a citizen very early on and stuff. And so my son, who is the third generation that's been here, still speaks Spanish. He speaks better than I do. And so we retain the culture as much as we can. But, you know, we're from this side of the border.
You're doing your part to retain the culture, too, by carrying on the Mexican harp.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, this is when I started playing it was something that a tradition that was we didn't know very well here in the United States. Although where I lived, there was a lot of it running around, people playing it.
Yeah.
So I got to learn from some of the great players from Veracruz and other places because they were in my neighborhood. Because there was no work in Mexico that had come up. Mm-hmm. So it's called Cuatro Milpas. Thank you.
Francisco Gonzalez, that was such a beautiful song. I can see that could be the anthem for people on the move. From the cornfields, you said.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. And you said that you grew up in
East
America.
LA.
In East L.A.
The second largest Mexican city. There's more Mexicans in L.A., and I always have been since... That's before the became part of the United States.
After Mexico City, East L.A.
East L.A. is a great part. We have more than the Guadalajara.
Wow.
And but the difference is that we don't have the regionality that that some places have. Like Tucson, they're particularly from Sonora and some from Chihuahua that came up there. And it's a particular part of the culture. Whereas in my neighborhood, I had people from everywhere, from Texas, New Mexico, California, old California families, Veracruz, Mexico City, everything. It was all mixed up. So we had everything.
East LA was the Mexican melting pot.
Very much so, yes. Uh-huh. And still is.
Yeah, yeah.
Except now that we have more Central American and Latin Americans than we used to have.
And the Mexican harp, it's a mariachi instrument, plus it's a solo instrument.
Actually, this is not mariachi.
Okay.
This is Veracruz. This harp is from the east coast of Mexico. Mariachi music comes from a very small corner of Jalisco, one little tiny bit.
Yeah.
It's like Fairbanks, compared to all of Alaska. But
they
it became
well
a national kind of sound during the 20s when they had... When radio started coming out, people started playing. So more and more people knew about it. And then movies started being made about it, the ranchero movies. They were like Mexican cowboy movies. But Mexico actually has more harp than any other country in the world.
Oh.
We have seven major styles of harp plus the subgenres.
Oh. I mean, you think of the Celtic harp and the Welsh harp being, very popular because you see that on the symphony orchestra stage and – But wow, the Mexican
Celtic harp and Welsh harp—you wouldn't see in a symphony. You'd see the pedal harp.
Those are the what?
The pedal harp, the chromatic harp. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's the the big one with the pedal, so they can change. That was the limitation for harp, where it died out in a lot of parts of Europe and even in Latin America. Was the limitations that it has that it's diatonic. That means that it doesn't have any chromatic notes. Oh. Pedal harp came along and they changed that, but it also made it an instrument that only the upper class could afford. So it the irony was that it came from Spain on the first boats, to Mexico. There was a harp maker.
Wow.
And it spread everywhere. The indigenous people loved it, and they made their own versions of it everywhere. Everywhere where Spanish was spoken, there was a harp. But in Spain, within 200 years of the conquest, it was gone. They had no more harp. It's barely being revived now again.
I can see
harp.
Why, because a good player like you can make it just sing. And you play it much like a classical guitarist would play a classical guitar, I would say, because you have the picking action on the strings.
Yes, the difference is, the major difference is that a guitar, you're playing your hands, they're in sequence with each other. Well, the way I play on the harp, I'm playing one line with one hand, and another line with the other hand. And so, and then singing.
How do you do that?
It's like
his
brain a piano
is divided
player.
In the middle. We put a piece of cardboard right there.
Right. So his brain is separated, yes.
It's strange, though, but that it actually gets to the point to where you try to play only one hand, and you can't do it because you want the other hand to do it too at the same time. It is very difficult. Yeah.
Yeah, I would say so. And not an easy instrument to travel with either.
No, it's huge. No.
It's as tall as you are. And so it really amazes me that you can get this all the way from Tucson to Alaska in
one piece.
We
almost didn't.
Really?
You're right. Luckily, I had a case made for a friend of ours, and the
kind
case
of a bulletproof
came out
case.
In practically, and it was destroyed. The top part was destroyed, but the harp was okay.
Oh, thank
goodness.
So it
saved the harp. It did what it was supposed to.
Yeah.
And the last
case didn't make it in one piece, but the harp did.
Yeah. The last trip that me and Michael took together, it didn't make it, period. It was destroyed in Heathrow in London.
Is this the same harp?
No, it's a different harp.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow, I'm so sorry to hear that.
Yeah, it was a major thing. So we were in Wales, we were playing in Wales, and I ended up having to play a Welsh harp.
Well, no.
But it was actually kind of good because the Welsh harp, you know, it's the tension on it's a lot different. It's a different mm-hmm. feel. But I was playing the stuff I played, and they don't play like that. So it became an attraction. And the Welsh company, the harp company, they have a national harp company to preserve the tradition. We called them, and they said, you can take any harp you want out of this museum cultural center that they have and use it for as long as you're here. And so it made the gigs a little bit more interesting. We were playing at one pub, an old pub that was how many years in existence?
Been in existence since 1640.
1640, yeah. And I walk in, and there was already a table there, a long table, and we were going to sit up in the corner, and there all these people are sitting there where they have their beers, and they're all looking at me, following me with their eyes. There's 12 of them, you know, and it was kind of unnerving. So as I was getting ready to tune up the harp, and I tuned up the other instruments I was using, and the owner came and said, yeah, all these people came to see you play harp.
Mm-hmm.
And believe me, before I started, they did not look happy. They were like, how dare you use our national instrument, you know, for your purposes. You know, but afterwards they were, as I started playing them, they were talking and saying, oh, how did he do that? Because it's a very different tradition.
Did you have people wanting to take lessons from you after that?
No, actually the harp I was using got sold.
Oh.
No, there was a woman there. She said, she told the company, when I was done with it, she wanted it. So they sold it immediately.
Oh, that's.
And so that was good. It was good, interesting, but it was, quite different than the way it felt and stuff like that, but it really made them connect more with what I was doing. You know, because stylistically, it's so very different.
We might have had to donate a pedal harp to you, and I don't know what you would have done with that here.
No.
Michael, was that a tough break when you had to break it to your friend Francisco that his harp had not made it to?
It was probably one of the hardest things I've ever done. It really was. Francisco's out at the grocery store or something, and mm-hmm. our luggage didn't make it from Heathrow, so it was the next day when they delivered it. And the guy pulled the case out of the truck, and I picked it up, and it just went, and I just thought, oh, my God, I almost cried.
It sounded like a pile of junk in there
pieces of wood.
Oh.
Really, it was smashed. And we had a friend in Wales that pieced it back together, so at least it came home in one piece, but it's not the same.
You know? Uh-huh.
Never will be so.
Right.
But that's...
It makes for a great story now, but it must have been just a horrific, just a horrific sight. And
yeah,
when
we pulled up, when we were pulling up to the house, I saw Michael standing in front, and he looked like somebody died.
Oh, no.
And I told Janet, our host, I said, the harp. And she said, no, not. And then I said, he came up to me and said, I'm so sorry. He was practically crying. I said, no, don't worry about it. We need to find a harp. That's what I said.
Next.
This is Wales. They have harps. And so within that same day, we talked to them. I got to talk to the master harp maker in Wales. And he said, well, we are a small brotherhood. And we have to help each other what we can because we're a small brotherhood. And I really love that. Yeah. That's the way he looked at it. Is,
yeah.
You know, harp, the harp, no matter where it was, is a harp. Yeah.
Human kindness, it really goes in a small circle of harpists, too, no matter mm-hmm. if you're a Welsh harpist or a Mexican harpist. Or, mm-hmm. Yeah, musicians, they take care of each other. That's really nice. Mm-hmm. Well, are we ready for another song from one or both of you?
I've been touring on the road for about the last probably 10 years, I guess. And so I sort of have adopted that model of a troubadour, and the troubadours, you know, throughout history have taken the news and the culture from where they live and helped to spread it throughout wherever they travel. And I'm very lucky in that I've done a lot of traveling in that 10 years. And so one of the things that I try and do, because the troubadours also brought news and culture back from their travels to their hometown. So a lot of the times where places that we go, things that affect me, and that's what affects my writing. And I'll get into the family history a little bit. You guys play Ronstadt Generations on this radio station, which I greatly appreciate. But that's my sons are fifth generation Ronstadts that have been doing music in the Southwest since the 1880s.
Wow, so, your great-great-grandfather or your great-grandfather?
My great-grandfather came from Germany in 1841, and he was a mining engineer, but he brought with him music. So I sort of am taking some liberty there, declaring him the first generation. But and then my grandfather he started the first Philharmonic Band in Tucson in 1889.
Really?
And then his daughter sang and all over the world and throughout the 20s, the teens, 20s, and 30s. And then my sister sings a little bit. And so,
oh, yeah, your sister Linda, you mean?
Yeah. And so I've been sort of carrying that tradition on. Yeah. In any event, a few years ago we were traveling up into West Virginia, and we'd been at an event called Common Ground on the Hill in Maryland that we go to every year. And one of the things that was talked about at Common Ground is it's a two-week event where musicians and artists from all over the world come and gather and exchange and do workshops and stuff. But one of the social issues that was being talked about there was mountaintop mining, which is very similar to the big open pit mining or to the strip mining or anything that they do. And we were headed up into West Virginia, and I was looking at a satellite picture of where we were going, and I was astounded at how much bare earth there was from the satellite. And so it sort of rolled around in my head and came out in this song.
Yeah.
And the other thing, because my great-grandfather was a mining engineer,
yeah,
we tend to do a lot of mining songs. You know?
So for you to see
how that's
been.
We'll do a couple of mining songs.
All right, great.
How that relates.
Well, the coal miner's job is no longer down under. No evil intentions, the families to feed, and the songs of the children heard in the valley, singing about families and the places they live. But now down in the valley, it's all peaceful and quiet. No sign of the tragic sadness above. While up on the mountain, there's nothing but flatness. Where once there were trees, now there's nothing but mud. Oh, the whippoorwill sings as the sun's shining softly. The wind's telling stories. Place is called home. Then the trees start to whisper of thunder and sadness as they steadily take down our mountaintop home. Shining way off in the darkness as the coal train keeps feeding our unstoppable need, and the answers lay hidden in the dust and the rubble. Those deep coal black lakes are the price of our dreams. Oh, the whippoorwill sings as the sun's shining softly. The wind's telling stories of places called home. Then the trees start to whisper thunder and sadness as they steadily take down our mountaintop home. Oh, the whippoorwill sings shining softly, the wind's telling stories, the place is called home. Then the trees start to whisper thunder and sadness as they steadily take down our mountaintop home. Then the trees start to whisper thunder and and sadness as we steadily take down our mountaintop home.
That was a beautiful song, and I like the way you describe yourself as a troubadour. You don't run into that so much these days, and I like that word and the description you used, and then to listen to that song through realizing that, you know, you take a message here, you take a message back home, and gosh, you know, trees will grow back, but mountains, they just don't grow back.
It's real hard. No, they don't.
You know? Yeah. Well, I guess it would take a very long time.
Yeah.
Very. So what makes it worse is that whole area is really like rainforest.
Yeah.
It's there's only a few inches of topsoil.
And it will wash right away if it doesn't
have...
Yeah,
the companies used to... I spent a lot of time in the mining area when I was friends with Apple Shop, which is an organization there of the culture of the mountains, and friends from Roadside Theater. And in Kentucky, for instance, it just looks bombed out. Mm. From all the strip mining, and it's an area that will never return to what it looks like. You know, you cross the state line from Kentucky, and you go into like a Big Stone Gap in Virginia, and it's like a whole different world. It's all green and beautiful the way it used to be, but they just destroyed. They took it away. They sold they bought people off with like $50, you know, the mineral rights. They didn't. They told them all we want is what's under your house. They never said they had to take the house.
Yeah, take the house too.
Mm-hmm. Oh, by the way.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that too. You can take the house with you.
Right.
Yeah, that's. Is there mining around Tucson too?
Yeah, there's a large copper mining industry around Tucson.
Gotcha. And Tucson is where your great-grandfather settled. Is that correct? You said
My great-grandfather came in. He actually came into to Chile from Germany and then went across and came up by ship to San Francisco and then overland to a little town about 150 miles southeast of Tucson called Banamachi, which is on the Rio Sonora down in Sonora. And he settled there managing a ranch for a guy named General Pesqueta. And because he had some previous military experience, he was inducted into the Army and ended up doing 5 tours of duty, became a colonel in the Mexican Army. And one of the things that he helped do was organize a horse brigade, which was responsible for kicking the French out of Hermosillo. But after that, he went back to mining. And my grandfather was born in that little town of Banamachi. Huh. And so in 1882, my great-grandfather thought my grandfather needed to have a profession. So he brought him to Tucson to live with some friends of his to learn how to be a blacksmith. And that's what my grandfather did. He's a blacksmith, and that developed into wagon making, and we had a big hardware business there. So he started that. But he had learned how to play the flute as a very young child of about between 8 and 10 years old. And then when he was 10, they settled in La Paz, and there was a gentleman there that taught music. So my grandfather learned music theory and all the different instruments. And so by the time he was getting ready to start the band in Tucson, they were able to talk the city into buying the major instruments. But some of the guys had their cornets and that type of stuff. But they didn't have enough money for the music, so my grandfather hand-wrote out all the parts. They bought the score, and then he hand-wrote all the pieces.
Because you said he started the Philharmonic.
He started the first Philharmonic band.
Philharmonic
it was like
band.
A Sousa band. Mm-hmm. Like, and the picture, the picture's in that CD cover there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you've got.
That's his band in 1889.
Oh, that is just so cool. It's all brass instruments, it looks like. And they're all. And what was that year?
1889.
And that's one of the pictures you have in the liner of your CD, Ronstadt Generations Prelude, mm-hmm. that came out a year or two ago.
Yeah, I tour with my two sons, and they're fifth generation.
Which is a little confusing when I was looking you up, because there's another Michael Ronstadt besides you in the
Michael
band.
Michael G. is my oldest son, yeah. And he's a lot more popular than I am. So I went from being Linda's brother to Michael's father.
And he plays cello.
He does.
And he plays, I found, now that I kind of keyed into the fact that you're not the same person, that's actually your son, I've found him on many CDs he's playing on. That's great. You really, folks that are out in radio land right now, seeing this harp is one of the things that is just, it's spectacular, the work on it. Did you do you know the artist that put all the work into it? Yeah.
The tradition is that most of the harp players, as they get older, learn how to make the harps.
No.
So this was made by Pedro Sosa, who used to live in Cosamalhuapan, Veracruz, and now he's in Mexico City. That's where he works regularly. And his family's there, but you know, they always go back to Veracruz every opportunity they have. And he's one of the very, very good makers. There's a lot more. There's a lot of interest in the harp in the United States and in Mexico. Again, it's a resurgence of it. As you were saying about the mariachi was actually a harp ensemble. There was no guitarrón, you know, the bass instrument.
Yeah.
The main thing of the harp, it was all surrounded by the harp, and the harp was the bass instrument. In Veracruz, the harp was melodic. And they use some other type of instruments with it, jaranas and stuff like that. And it's a whole different repertoire. And then there's harps from Chihuahua. And every state had its harp. And you can still find little pockets of people who play the traditional harps in the way they used to play them. In Zacatecas, in Durango, California, Arizona, they still use harp. The Yaquis still use harp in Arizona. No, Mexico, there's still some, a couple of players. There was one even in Colorado recently, I think, one of the old traditional.
Francisco, have you been teaching younger harp players?
Somewhat. I'm not a real big teaching fan. but yes, I do have people who play with it. Tradition is that you're supposed to learn by playing jarana with the harp player, and you learn as you're watching him. And so subsequently, there's a lot of different styles within the genre, you know, within one particular genre, the subgenres, up to the point where some of these little towns all have their style.
Their style. And so I bet you have a keen ear and you can probably hear that.
But the thing is that those of us that learned in California, which is like the second capital of Mexican harp, we have our own language, our own patois, you know, how we play. So when we meet up with other harp players from other parts, we play together. We'll play the same song together, but our melodic and usage is different. And we both like kind of, wow, how did you do that? Wow, you know, it's like, it's really interesting. Because the repertoire of songs is not real, real big because it's a lot of improvisation involved. It's like bebop.
It's like jazz, you know, and bebop.
Yeah, exactly like bebop. I used to play a lot of bebop.
Really?
On upright bass, yeah. And that's the thing that I like about the harp, is that there's all this room for improvisation.
Yeah.
And you really, when you're playing, there's some people who play, like they used to say, exactly like the record. You know, every note is exactly the same every time they play it. But then there's a lot of people, there's the improvisational. And I'm in that school of where I play the head and then I improvise. I don't really know what I'm going to play when I start. I just play the head and then I play. So it's interesting, like that way. It's a living thing. And the movement happening in California and Texas and stuff like that of the los jaraneros, which is when they play the instrument that goes with the harp, it's a very big thing. It's like a counterculture kind of alternate to it's like the answer to the mariachi dress up in gala stuff, you know, and it's very middle class, and they teach it in the schools, and it's basically a dead form because there's no more improvisation left in mariachi.
Oh. Yeah,
they don't talk about like what song are you going to play, you know, what kind of song. They talk about what arrangement you play, you know, and so it's not there anymore.
Interesting.
And then this it is, and with the jaraneros it is verse. You know, you do verses and stuff like that. So it's right now it's everywhere in California. There's people who are doing fandango, dancing to it, and doing fandango, which is the dance, the actual, you know, the way you do the rules for the dances and everything like that. People get together and they have people call it tarima or the huapango itself. It's a percussion stage, and with the feet they do rhythms with the feet.
Oh,
and that is pre-Colombian.
Oh, and pre-flamenco.
They got the flamenco from Mexico. Yes, nice. they took a lot of musicians from Mexico and took them to the royal courts. And so a lot of these songs became very fashionable, the dances. And they danced them. Some of them are very graceful in different places. There's no zapateado, no shoes, mm-hmm. kind of thing. But the huapango is. They dance without shoes on, but they dance on the wood, you know, to use the yeah. percussion. And that's coming back. That's just a participatory kind of music that doesn't exist anymore. Like here, we used to have, you know, toy dances and stuff like that. Where people callers and stuff. All of that calling stuff
we have
comes
that.
Back, comes from the way the music was played in Mexico. Mm-hmm. That was taken to Europe, went back. You know, there's the contra dance, yeah. right? That was made, it comes from the word country dance. Right, and when the Spanish couldn't say country dance, so they say contra danza, contra dance. Then it went back to England and came here and were doing contra dance, thinking that it's from, you know, originally from Spain. No, it was English, you know, uh-huh. but with influences from the New World. There was a lot of coming and going.
Contra dance and square dance is definitely making a resurgence. Mm-hmm. It's back in Fairbanks, going strong with both kinds, with the mm-hmm. collar, like you say, and participatory, and it's mm-hmm. very fun, you know, the live band there, and gosh, that's just a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was the first Chicano harp player ever to play at the Carter Fold, you know, the Carter family in Virginia.
Oh, yeah.
And I got to play with Jeanette and Joe, you know, before they passed.
The Carter family, yeah.
And it was funny because, you know, I'm playing harp, and I'm doing gold watch and chain with a banjo and fiddle. And,
yeah.
Fit right in.
Yeah, right there. Yeah, they loved it. And the next week I wasn't there, but my friend went, and he said to Jen, said, "You should have been here last week. There was a boy here with the biggest old Audi harp you ever did see."
Oh, they thought it was kind of like auto harp.
Of course.
Well, you guys ready to play another? Michael Ronstadt and Francisco Gonzalez join me here for Alaska Live, right here in the KUAC studios.
My grandfather, as I had mentioned, was born in the little town of Banamichi in the late 1800s. And because his father was a mining engineer, they traveled to many of the little towns and villages throughout what's now Sonora and also down into the Baja California region. When my grandpa was a little boy of about 8 years old, they lived in a place called Santa Rosalia, which is about halfway down the Baja Peninsula on the eastern seashore. And as a little boy, his job for the family was to take a donkey and some wooden barrels and go up about a 5-kilometer path to a freshwater spring, which was above the village there. He would follow the men of the village on their mules and bigger barrels. And so they would finish filling those barrels. And many times it would be in the summertime, I'm sure. Even in the wintertime, it's not very cold down there. It gets hot and dusty. And so they would come back down that trail, and a little stream follows that trail. And where that stream meets the ocean, it forms what's called a palmar, or a palm grove. And this was my grandfather's favorite song. It was a song, the melody is probably from Spain. But who knows, it may have come here and then gone to Spain and back, like Francisco said. But it was very popular in the mid-1800s. And it's about a little huerfanita, an orphan girl, who lives in a palmar, very much like that one in Santa Rosalia. When I was 10 years old, my dad took me, we got some mules, and we rode some trails hoping to find the palmar that my grandpa used to visit. And I think we did. We found a beautiful little palm grove with a fresh pool of crystal clear water and some papaya trees and date palms. And I often thought that was probably where my grandpa would stop and swim when he was a little boy. But when he'd hear the song, a little tear would come to his eye because it's a very sad song. It's about this huerfanita. She lives in a palmar and she has no friends, no one to console her, no mother, no father. And she comes and goes out of the palmar like the waves of the sea. Thank you.
de un palmar. Yo vi una joven bella, su boquita de coral, sus ojitos dos estrellas. Pasar le pregunté que quién estaba con ella y me respondió llorando, sola vivo en el palmar. Soy no tengo padre ni madre, ni un amigo hay que me venga a consolar. Solita pasó la vida a la orilla de y solita voy y vengo como las olas del mar. Tengo padre ni madre, ni un amigo hay que me venga a consolar. Solita pasó la vida a la orilla de palmar y solita voy y vengo como las olas del mar y solita voy y vengo como las olas del mar.
Francisco Gonzalez playing Mexican harp and Michael Ronstadt playing guitar and both singing on that beautiful song that was your grandfather's favorite song.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. Can I make a request that you come back in the winter and bring your warm stories and the sound?
You tell me when we'll be here.
Because
I actually sent a letter to the South Pole saying, we'd love to come to the South Pole.
Yeah.
I like touring in the winter. One of the reasons I like that is just because of what you said.
Mm-hmm.
The audiences are wonderful, and it's something that gives people a little something to do.
Yeah, and
come back in a second.
The warmth that I feel from these songs is just, I'd love to feel that if it was 30 below.
It's a song, the canción is a song form that was popular starting around the 1860s, 1870s. And up and through the 20s, and then it started getting a lot of different influences in Mexico because of the recording. The recording started. And my mother used to say that the more modern songs, for her, when she was a kid, like in the late 20s, that her grandfather would come and say, no, that's not music. A canción is a real song. And sing this type of song that we just sang with a lot of rubato, a lot of, mm-hmm. you know, long notes and this whole stylistic thing. It was interesting in that a lot of these songs that they say, okay, well, they're Spanish in California, that they say, oh, these are the old Spanish songs from California, don't exist in Spain. They never did. You can find them in Mexico. You can find them in the archives. And there was this one gentleman who was a descendiente or one of the original families of the soldiers that came and founded Santa Barbara by the name of Ruiz, his last name. He said Ruiz. And he said, I went to Spain to look for these songs, and I didn't find anything. And I told him, you might as well go to the North Pole and look for banana trees, because they ain't going to find them. And, a lot of the songs, use, there's words, there's keywords that are not Spanish, but mm-hmm. actually native words mm-hmm. in the different regional canciones that you hear mm-hmm. and in the canción. Although a lot of the canción came, you know, like I said, once the recording happened, then people like Lidia Mendoza, who was recording in the 20s already, was hearing these songs like a milonga or a tango from Argentina, and they were influencing how they played, and it changed, the whole dynamic changed, you know, with the coming of the recording. It was, I always call it the revenge of the oral tradition.
Francisco, are you asked to speak at colleges because you are a music historian? You know so much about the craft. It's just amazing.
I've lectured a lot.
Yeah.
I don't like to teach.
My
wife is a professor. That's good enough.
Yeah.
I've lived on campuses for 30-something years. That's enough.
But so I guess your wife ropes you into coming to classes.
The reason why also that I know a lot about this stuff is that mm-hmm. I was musical director. I was in theater for almost 20 years.
Okay.
And I was musical director for Teatro Campesino for the last European tour in 1980. And when we'd write plays or stuff like that, and of course, if I wrote plays for Santa Barbara, I'd have to do the research on the songs and get the spirit of the music. And so I used to have to really, like, you know, lower myself down in, head underwater in the stuff so that it would just come out naturally, like the way they played it.
Yeah, it's called immersion, and you did that, and I can tell.
That's what you have to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, and one play, there was an expert on California music, and she said, this song, where did you find that song? I mean, I've never heard it. I've never found it in the annals of Charles Lewis, who's running around with the electrical, I mean, the latest technology at the time.
Which to record,
the, Edison cylinders, right? And I said, no, I wrote it. And she said, no, you couldn't have written it. You couldn't have written it. No, where did you get it? And I wrote it. There's a lot of, in the fact of the Southwest, we have a very big problem with history, because, you know, as they say, history is written by the conqueror. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of things are suppressed. For instance, like I say about the Zapateado, when flamenco came back from Spain, and they saw the people doing it, they said, oh, well, they're just imitating our style. You know, with flamenco means, you know, Flemish. And mm-hmm. the gypsies came to Spain from the lower lands, which were at the time run by Spain. They were part of Spain, protectorate of Spain. So the gypsies went there, and then they came down to Spain and danced, and they learned that stuff there. It wasn't Spanish, you know, originally.
Interesting.
A lot of stuff that they say, well, that's a Spanish song, you know, obviously. You know, they don't have them. You ask Spaniards, you go there. I've done it with, you know, people from Spain, musicians from Spain, and they don't know the songs that are supposedly Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of it's like a hangover from the colonialism that we're just barely starting to get out of.
Right, and you know, spreading the information like you do, it really helps to learn the history of the song, and I think it makes the experience so much richer. Do you guys do a lot of small venue, like house concert type stuff, where you can do some of this speaking with the audience, and they want to know more? And do you guys do that?
We do a lot of house concerts.
Okay, a lot of house concerts. Yeah, I can tell.
I think that's one of the things that's bringing music back, right?
Yeah.
I think house concerts are a very important part of the music scene.
Yeah, I do it a lot in California. And what I'll do there is I'll use a local jaranista, you know, somebody playing
mm-hmm.
jarana.
Mm-hmm.
I'll use the local ones to play with me there, but I'll do mostly solo, and I'll do different stuff from different places. And at first, I hardly talked at all, but they started, you know, when I did tell the story of a couple of songs that I've written, you know, they said, that was great. You should tell more. You should talk more. And yeah. Okay. You know, so usually you don't want to sit there and listen to a lecture. You come to listen to music and yeah. get loaded. And
well, yeah. That's when you go to a bar to hear the music. Yeah, well.
Yeah.
You were influential in the early years of Los Lobos, Francisco.
I was the founding member.
Yes. And they went a different direction of, you know, bigger, like, you know, stadiums and such. And you stayed with the real roots of the music.
I went more into it. See, we all played rock and roll together
uh-huh.
first, okay? And then came up with the idea of Los Lobos de Los Angeles, where we played for our mothers. That was the real reason. I started learning
you
some Mexican stuff.
You played for your mothers.
That was the idea, oh. to show that we hadn't forgotten our roots. And it just, it was the right thing for the time. So we used to, it was totally, we did a lot of stuff that was paradoxical in terms of, like, we didn't dress up like mariachis or we had long hair and,
oh,
you know.
Oh, you're rock and roll. As,
yeah. Then all of a sudden we come out and be playing, you know, Mexican songs. And we speak
and
English on stage before we started.
Early 70s, right?
Early 70s, okay. Yeah. And then I left them in 76, but I still played once in a while with them. Mm-hmm. And then they went back into the rock and roll. You know, and I was in theater. I was a musical director for teatro. Yeah. And so I stayed in that venue. And when I continued doing theater and writing, music composing and musical direction and stuff like that, you know, for a long time until I started the business of making the strings for the ends of these instruments because we couldn't get them.
Oh,
they couldn't get them in Mexico. None of all. These
making strings here, for the harp.
I designed these. Yeah, these are. They're my design.
And are they nylon?
They are nylon wrapped around nylon. It's called Tynex. It's a special kind of nylon. And they used to use gut.
Uh-huh.
And the harps like this, were gut. And so, but gut has more flexibility than like a hard core. So I worked with the fiber to bring it, to make it more like silk. And these get that gut sound without the gut problems. I mean, gut will get out of tune from moving from one room to the next, and I got into that, and I only wanted to do harp strings, but then all of a sudden I was doing rockabilly basses DuPont, you know, the Soundboard guitars, gypsy jazz strings, everything that people couldn't get from Gibson or from other companies. Ernie Ball lived in the same state, not too far from where I lived. And they would actually give out my name. They called me one time and said if they could do that because there was a lot of stuff that people would call for, and they couldn't make it because they run these big machines that spit out the same size of a string, you know, 12 gross a day with two machines, but it takes them 2 days to set it up to make the next one.
Right.
And then maybe I could make it in a couple of minutes, changing mm-hmm. stuff around. Mm-hmm. So I got exposed to a lot of musical instruments that I wouldn't have otherwise. And a lot of different harps, a lot of different styles.
And how many strings are on your particular harp?
36.
36. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of strings to keep in tune.
30 more than I would like.
I know, right? You got it, Michael.
The harp is a different world. It is.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's one of those instruments, at least in our tradition, that if you can play it, you're naturally given the title of like maestro, you know, like master.
Maestro, yes.
They call me maestro, oh. And there's many different levels of it, how it's played, and many different styles. Like I said, Mexico, the whole seven styles of Mexico, at least in Venezuela, there's like three distinct styles of playing, and there's some in Argentina in the north, and Chile has its own harp, and Paraguay, Guarani harp is the national instrument. Every Guatemala still has a little bit of harp. All the Latin American countries had them, and in some places it became uncool because you know they wanted to do the modern songs. You know,
Francisco. You are the first harpist I've ever had on Alaska Live. I have not had any other harpist in here, and so it's very nice to have a maestro like you. So, should we hear another song? Okay.
We'll play one from another mining song. Is that
right? Another mining song sounds great.
Oh, we're in F here. That's the other thing with this type of harp.
Right, he can change keys without any visual signals for you.
Keys. He doesn't, I do.
Oh.
It's only been in the recent last maybe 10 years that they've been using Sharpie levers.
Oh, okay.
Because in the tradition, Harocho tradition, you don't change keys. You don't
need
keys.
Interesting.
In fact, they don't have even in the Paraguayo thing, they say they're in Do. I mean, everybody, Americans think they mean C, right? But for them, Do is just the first note of the scale. So a lot of Americans would buy these Paraguayo harps and they tune them up to C and they blow up. The strings weren't cut for C. Okay. Introducer.
Yep. This is a John Prine song about a little place called Paradise. The way John does it is way different than the way that I've interpreted it. And it has, this particular version has some of the elements of the Mexican rhythms that you'll hear a little bit.
We'll recognize it.
You might. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Completely recognize that, but I like the version that you play. That
Harocho
was
Billy.
Harocho Billy, I like that.
Yeah, that's what we called it when we were playing in at Apple Shop. a fiddle player and a banjo.
Yeah.
We were playing Harutabili.
Harutabili. Oh, thank you for being my guests on Alaska thank Live. You. Michael Ronstadt and Francisco Gonzalez.
Thank you.
Thanks. It's easy as
You can find full episodes of Alaska Live TV and download audio podcasts of the Alaska Live radio show online at KUAC.org. Alaska Live TV, music and conversation from the KUAC FM studio, is made possible by a grant from Design Alaska, architecture and engineering for the new frontier.